Dontaesboxingnation, what's going on, guys? So Vergil Ortiz, he stops Maurice Hooker in the seventh round in a very entertaining fight. But with that being said, now we have to get into the good news and the bad news. Which one do you guys want to hear first? Let's go ahead and start with the good news. The good news is Vergil Ortiz, he just got past the biggest test of his career, stopping Maurice Hooker. Vergil Ortiz was relentless. He hit Maurice with everything in the book. He even got caught with some good shots, and he did not get deterred. Now, because Maurice Hooker, he has no defense. He stands straight up, and he does not move his head. He got hit more times in the first round than Ortiz got hit in the whole fight. At least that's the way it looked to me when I watched it. Now, even though Ortiz was the aggressor in the fight, because of Hooker's poor defense, it kind of looked like Ortiz was the master boxer and Hooker was just some one-dimensional brawler. I mean, Ortiz was just landing everything. Beautiful jabs, double jabs, triple jabs. It got to the point where it looked like Ortiz, he could land punches with his eyes closed. So even though this wasn't the biggest test, this wasn't the toughest test that Ortiz could have took, it was still the biggest test compared to all the other opponents that Ortiz has been in the ring with. If he wanted a real test, he should have been in there with more of a Jaron Ennis. That way we would have the battle of the two undefeated fighters. So this wasn't that with Maurice Hooker. But I'll tell you, the good thing about Ortiz fighting Hooker is it was a great way to promote a possible Terrence Crawford fight. You had Maurice Hooker, who's good friends with Terrence Crawford, has been working with him for years. He's training alongside with Terrence Crawford. So that once again makes for a great promotion, not to mention the fact, as Don King always says, race sells. So you have a Mexican fighter knocking out a black fighter that once again trains with Terrence Crawford. That's already going to give a lot of Ortiz fans confidence that Vergil Ortiz is perhaps the man to beat Terrence Crawford. So I just gave you guys all the good news. Now it's time for the bad news. Let me start by saying this. You know, guys, before I watched this fight, I thought there was a very, very good chance that we were going to get to see Terrence Crawford versus Ortiz if there's not a Crawford versus Sean Porter fight. Or maybe, who knows, maybe it could be Crawford versus Porter and then Crawford versus Ortiz, or the winner, I should say, the winner of Porter versus Crawford against Ortiz. But after this performance, I'm just a little pessimistic when it comes to this fight coming to fruition, the whole Crawford versus Ortiz fight. Because if Hooker was able to weather the storm, at least for the first like 5-6 rounds, where he was constantly getting hit over and over, and these were power shots, for him to be able to come back after a couple rounds of getting hit over and over and over again, and then start landing clean shots of his own, and even having Ortiz looking a little banged up or bruised up after the fight, I truly believe Oscar De La Hoya, Ortiz's promoter, he's saying to himself, Ortiz is not ready. Ortiz is not ready for a Terrence Crawford or even an Errol Spence. You know, guys, in boxing and more recently, we often hear this not ready line. When it came to Canelo Alvarez, all of the Canelo Alvarez fans said that he wasn't ready for Floyd Mayweather. That's why he lost. When it comes to Ryan Garcia, you hear Ryan's own team, Oscar De La Hoya, Canelo Alvarez, and his trainers insinuating, implying that he's not ready for Tank Davis. Now, we already know when it comes to the situation with Ortiz, a lot of people are going to say he's not ready for Terrence Crawford. In fact, Ortiz even said after the fight, when he was asked, do you think you're ready? And Ortiz surprisingly said, I don't care if I'm ready or not, I want the fight. Now, give him credit for being honest, but at the same time, I don't like the way he answered that question, because it comes off like you're not even sure if you're ready to fight this guy. You're not sure if you can beat him. In reality, if we're being honest, when you hear fans or trainers or whoever say this guy is not ready, that guy is not ready, that's really just a nice way of saying the other guy is better than you. That's really what it means. I mean, don't get me wrong. This is not to imply a fighter cannot get better, because he can. But when it comes to Ortiz, he's not going to get better fighting punching bags like Maurice Hooker. The only way he's going to get better is by facing better competition. That means getting in there with the undefeated Jaron Ennis. That means getting in there with an experienced Danny Garcia or Sean Porter. Guys in the top five of the welterweight division, you beat one of those guys, that's going to make you better. But you're not going to get better fighting this level of opposition. I mean, I think if we're all being honest, even some of the most diehard Ortiz fans, I think we could all agree that Ortiz is not ready for a Terrence Crawford. I don't even think he's ready for an Errol Spence. And I don't even know if he could beat a Sean Porter. But once again, these are the type of opponents he should be going after. Especially Danny Garcia. Danny Garcia, he's already lost to all of the best fighters at welterweight. So he's pretty much a gatekeeper at 147 now. But then again, Danny is talking about moving up to 154. So, I mean, but these are the type of opponents that Ortiz needs to go after, a Keith Thurman. But you know, it's crazy because right now, Ortiz, he really has nowhere to go but up. You know, I mean, he's in the situation, if you compare him to like a Canelo Alvarez, it's easy for Canelo to maneuver and avoid some of the toughest competition. He can move up to a higher weight class, or he could just fight weak opposition in the same weight class. When it comes to Ortiz, he doesn't really have those options. Because first of all, this will be his first title fight when he does fight, and all of the champions are very dangerous. We're talking about Errol Spence and Terrence Crawford. Ortiz doesn't have the easy Caleb Smiths, the Rocky Fieldings, the Billy Joe Saunders, even Caleb Plant. Those are easier opponents than an Errol Spence or a Terrence Crawford. So this is the dilemma that Ortiz has. That puts more pressure on Ortiz to step up and fight against some of the most dangerous fighters in the entire sport of boxing. I mean, remember, just to give you guys some contrast, Canelo Alvarez's first title fight was against Matthew Hatton. Matthew Hatton, a guy who was actually a welterweight, they had him move up to 154 to fight for a vacant title against Canelo Alvarez. Matthew Hatton wasn't even ranked in the top 10 as a welterweight, and here he was fighting against Canelo for a vacant belt at super welterweight. So my point is, you got to give Ortiz a lot of credit, because even though he hasn't signed a contract yet, he's pursuing a Terrence Crawford fight. Maybe he'll change his mind, I don't know. But if he continues to push for a Terrence Crawford fight, you have to look at the fact that while Canelo was fighting a Matthew Hatton for his first title shot, Ortiz, he's putting it all on the line, and he's going after pound for pound the best fighter in the world, Terrence Crawford. Let's see if it happens. Let's see if Oscar De La Hoya allows it to happen. But, you know, I say let's see if Oscar allows it to happen. I truly believe that if Ortiz, like, really, really wanted this fight and he was not taking no for an answer, Oscar would have to oblige him. Oscar would have to allow Ortiz to fight Crawford. If Ortiz, he put his foot down like Canelo did when he decided to fight Edison de Lara. We already know Oscar De La Hoya already admitted that he did not want Canelo to fight Lara, but it was Canelo that wanted to take the fight because Mexican fans from Mexico started to put a lot of pressure on Canelo to take that fight ever since Lara jumped on the stage and called him out. So let's see if Ortiz, he puts his foot down the same way Canelo did to make the Lara fight. That's all I got for now, guys. I'm on to the next one. Fellas, I've got some great news for you. If you've lost your hair or have a receding hairline, the time has come when you can finally get your hairline back through a process called scalp micropigmentation. So here's how it works. It's a hair tattoo that replicates the look of your hair follicles when you have fully shaved it down. So to get this hookup, make sure you follow and contact my man, Scalp Carolinas. All right, now check this out, guys. If you're looking to repair eczema scars, burns and bruises, dark spots and blemishes, then this right here is the perfect product for you guys. It's called Elodiki Face and Body Oil. Athletes and top-ranking boxers, they're also using it after training to reduce swelling, inflammation, and to ease the pain. So get yours today. Go to elodiki.com, like them on Facebook, and follow them on Instagram.
This is Bobby, and you're watching Dante's Boxing Nation.
Love that.